they pick the images. Welcome to Scrammble Game Show. As you have just seen the intro, we have a guest today. And this guest actually is a friend of ours and been here before. Topic's very interesting. If you have heard it before, you certainly should continue stay tuned with this one. But if you have not, I think you will find this a treat for you. Tonight, our guest is Miss Charlotte Rees. Hi, Charlotte.
Hi.
Thank you for coming.
Well, thank you for inviting me.
Right. We had interviewed about, close to a year now, right?
Right, a year and a half ago.
You've been here, right. And that was a very exciting show, I mean, including our crew here, everybody excited about that show. And certainly, it's very surprising to most of the people, you know, how America was recovered. So let's do a little recap for the previous, you know, sort of discussion. Then we continue to the new program today because you have been traveling, you have to gather new evidence and so on. Mm-hmm. We really want to get into that. So let's recap a little bit. Of course, we started out with your father's map.
Right.
Right?
And my father had found this map in Korea, actually in a Korean antique shop in 1972.
Yeah.
And then he had done a lot of research and he wrote a book. Mm-hmm. And the book was The Asiatic Fathers of America.
Right. We'll probably have it here. Let
right.
Me
this is the right. My abridgment
oh,
of
good.
His
yes.
that I wrote of his book, mm-hmm. The Asiatic Fathers of America.
Mm-hmm.
And his book was showing the Chinese discovery and colonization of ancient America.
Mm-hmm.
And at the time that he wrote the book, in the 70s, at that time, I was in my 20s, mm-hmm. and I was...
With lots of other interests.
A lot of other interests. You're right. You're right. Yeah. And I guess like a typical 20-some-year-old, yeah. you know, there were other issues in life that, to me, were more pressing. I was starting my own family, and I just wasn't interested.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't really think too much of what he had to say.
Mm-hmm.
But it was in 2003, early 2003, after I read someone else's book that I said, well, maybe my father was right. So I got out his book
mm-hmm.
and started going through it. And then I contacted several other people who had been doing similar research.
Yeah, this whole issue, who discovered America, seemed to be a top secret. People don't really talk openly until recently.
Right. Right.
So you read that book, that's by this British author, right?
Right, right. And then I said, well, now I need to go and study my father's book, see what he had to say.
Mm-hmm.
And in the process, I found that some other people had written books about my father's book.
Mm.
And one of the people who had written a chapter in one of the books was Dr. Cyclone Covey.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And Dr. Covey So I contacted him and said, well, has all this been disproved? Because by now, it's like 2003, my father wrote his book in 73, a lot of years have passed. Mm-hmm. And Dr. Covey says, no, there's so much more new information, mm-hmm. and if you will pursue
this.
And
Dr. Covey is a historian.
Yes, and he's studied Chinese exploration to America, mm-hmm. for 60 years.
Wow.
Now, Dr. Covey passed away late last year. Mm-hmm. But for several years, he was my research mentor.
Right, right.
Very kind to me.
Yeah, that was, you know, previously when we talked about that, and you mentioned about, you know, how he helped you and so on. And
right.
also you met some of the people that through conferences and so on.
Right. So I've had the opportunity to go to many different places. I just feel very blessed. You know, I spoke at the Library of Congress and also at the University of London, mm-hmm. and at the top universities in China, one mm-hmm. time at Tsinghua, mm-hmm. and one time last December I was at Peking University.
Both top universities.
Yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And so I've had good receptions at places mm-hmm. I've been, but I've had a lot of good opportunities, and right. I feel very blessed.
So the first book you wrote is this, the abridged version of
yes,
your father's
it's
book.
Yes, it's the abridged version
of
my father's book.
And then later on,
book.
You have written more. Shall
right,
we well, sort of review a little bit before we get into the new ones?
Right, then I came out with Secret Maps of the Ancient World.
Oh, yes.
I'll reach for that one.
Yeah. Hmm?
And this gives more modern information that's come out, like the DNA studies,
mm-hmm.
and it gives a lot of comparisons of the Native American customs,
mm-hmm.
to the ancient Chinese customs.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things that I'll just mention briefly along this, in California within the past year,
mm-hmm.
some of the Native Americans wanted to do the rain dance,
mm-hmm.
and they had forgotten how.
Mm-hmm.
So who did they turn to but the Buddhists to teach them, because their dances were identical.
I see.
But they turned to the Chinese Buddhists to, uh-huh. to teach them how. So, mm-hmm. But there are a lot of correlations, and I had mentioned that in this book too, that the ceremonies, a lot of the religious ceremonies mm-hmm. were the same. In so many different ways, the
yeah.
things that the Native Americans
the custom
did.
Of greeting people and
right. They both said how.
Say how. Yeah.
How. Yeah.
Yeah.
So there are many things that were the same,
mm-hmm.
and so and of course I'm not the only one who studied this. There have been many scholars who've studied different areas of this, and continue to study different areas of mm-hmm. this. And this book brings many of those studies together in one book.
Mm-hmm.
It's heavily footnoted.
Yeah,
and
right,
some,
lots of reference. Mm-hmm.
Some colleges have used this as a textbook
mm-hmm.
to for people to check it out.
Mm. Very good. That's your second book, right?
Right, mm-hmm. right.
Mm-hmm. Then later on you have written another book, right? Isn't third book?
Well, I wrote The Chinese Sail to America Before Columbus,
uh-huh.
if you want to hand me that one.
This one,
This book is now out of print, though,
mm-hmm.
Because I changed publishers.
Mm-hmm.
And so early this year, I brought it out under this title and mm-hmm. expanded it and brought it out under this title.
Oh, I see, the New World Secrets.
And this is basically about my father's map collection
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
and other
maps, too. Yeah.
Right, other similar mm-hmm. Maps.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what that book is about.
Yeah. Well, okay. Well, this is a sort of our recap, just to
right.
let audience, you know, sort of know that we have talked about this previously in the past. So
mm-hmm.
we will, in this less than an hour, let's sort of go over some of the new stuff that you've been doing since, say, 2007 or 2008.
Well, I started in 2003,
mm-hmm.
and then. It's sort of built, one thing builds on the next.
Yeah.
And I'm really excited about this book,
mm-hmm.
Did Ancient Chinese Explore America? My Journey Through the Rocky Mountains to Find Answers.
Mm-hmm.
And this goes back to an American author
mm-hmm.
in 1953.
Mm-hmm.
She took the Chinese document, which is called the Shanghai Jing.
Right. This is a place probably we should do a little footnote. Shanghai Jing is a very old book.
Right.
And it's probably one of the oldest geography book.
Mm-hmm.
But of course, in those days, people don't really consider geography as a sort of a discipline of a scholarly or academic, you know, domain. And sometimes people even mix sort of novels and the stories with these geography books. But right. Shanghai Jin actually had a lot of descriptions. Maybe at those days, people don't believe or don't understand or whatever. Mm-hmm. And suddenly now is being rediscovered, so to speak.
Right. Mm-hmm. So the Shanghai Jing, according to one scholar in 83 BC, mm-hmm. he said that the Shanghai Jing was written around 2000 BC, which would have been the time of China's first dynasty.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And we know that China's first dynasty was around that period of time mm-hmm. because 14 years ago, the Chinese government did an extensive study mm-hmm. with 400 scholars, mm-hmm. and they said, we want to find out when our first dynasty started.
Yeah.
And so they actually took them back, mm-hmm. and their conclusion, which they came to in the year 2000, was that it went back to about 2070 BC.
Mm-hmm.
But for simplicity, I always round it off to 2000 BC.
That's close enough.
Right. Yeah. Right. So they said it was about that time that Chinese first dynasty. So some people attribute it to mm-hmm. 2000 BC, mm-hmm. but we know that it was quoted several times by partial names like Shan Jing, or maybe not Shan Hai Jing, but Shan Jing or different Hai Jing.
Yeah. Well, this again, I can put a footnote on this. Shan Hai Jing is three letters or three characters. Mm-hmm. San, it means mountain.
Exactly.
Hai means ocean.
Right.
Jing means volumes of a print or handwriting or writing.
Mm-hmm.
This Jing word can be used, for example, Bible is called a Sen Jing.
Yes.
Sen is saint,
oh,
right?
Mm-hmm.
So saint writings. So mm-hmm. the Jing. So this three word is mountain, ocean, writings.
Right.
So it's a very typical name for geography.
But because it was so old and it mm. happened so long ago that today many people have forgotten mm. where they actually went. And there are accounts that there were maps mm-hmm. at the beginning,
mm-hmm.
but those maps were separated from the Shanghai Jing writing.
I see.
So the Shanghai Jing writing says, go so far, you'll see this, go so far. Well, how do you know so far from what?
Mm-hmm.
You know, so sometimes they forgot where they went. And for a long time in China, they tried to match it up with just with China.
Mm-hmm.
But the name Hai in there, seas, the ocean,
mm-hmm.
it implies that they
go overseas, yeah.
Overseas.
Mm-hmm.
And so my studies have basically been about the eastern mountains,
mm-hmm.
which the Chinese couldn't match. They could match a lot of the things up in China,
mm-hmm.
but they couldn't match up the eastern mountains.
Mm-hmm.
Well, what's east of China? Well, mm-hmm. maybe Japan, but Japan wasn't quite large enough
mm-hmm.
for the dimensions that they give.
Mm-hmm.
And in 1953, a Chicago attorney named Henrietta Mertz, she took the Shanghai Jing directions
mm-hmm.
and topographical world maps,
mm-hmm.
and she was looking at the eastern mountains, and she said, this doesn't fit anywhere in the world
mm-hmm.
but North America.
Mm-hmm.
And so she matched.
This is her name?
Henrietta Mertz.
Henrietta, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Henrietta Mertz.
This is the one that actually sort of motivated you to take the trip, to travel.
Right. Well, I read her book,
mm-hmm.
and I said, well, I don't believe everything I read.
Mm-hmm.
And she sold a lot of books. I mean, she had sold a lot of books, but mm-hmm. she was not able to make the journey herself. She was older.
Mm-hmm.
She was a single lady. She didn't have somebody to go with her on this journey.
Mm-hmm.
And it involves several 14,000 feet high mountains.
Oh, yes. Yeah, that's a very and challenging trip. Yeah.
Yeah, 1,100 miles.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's a long way. And there's some, still today, there are some many wild, dangerous animals in this area.
Mm-hmm.
I was fortunate
mm-hmm.
that when I started this, that first I got my brother to go on part of it with me.
Mm-hmm.
And then
that's David, right?
No, that's, my brother is Hendon.
Oh, Hendon.
Hendon.
Yeah.
He went, we went to the southern part first.
Oh, uh-huh.
And we went to Texas
mm-hmm.
because this one particular journey, the one that goes through the Rocky Mountains, she mm-hmm. charted four journeys, by the way, but the mm-hmm. one that goes through the Rocky Mountains, it ends up in West Texas.
Mm-hmm.
And so Hendon and I went to West Texas, and we said, so much of this is matching
the Shanghai Jing
Right. So there's no way this is wrong. For instance, we were on one mountain that is today called Baldy Peak, and the Chinese called it Bald Mountain. Mm-hmm. And they said, in this area is something that looks like suckling pigs. Mm-hmm. And we saw them running wild. They said that it looked like miniature suckling pigs. Mm-hmm. The only pig-like animal native to North America even runs wild there today. It's called peccary. Mm-hmm. And they said that, but they have pearls. I mean, what does that mean, have pearls? Well, Henrietta Mert said that she thought it was the peccary, and they have little tusks that stick out right at the edge of their lips, and it looked like little pearls right beside their lips.
Yeah.
And so we were on the top of Bald Mountain, and I was looking over the desert, and it said the next mountain is Bamboo Mountain.
So when Henrietta sort of rode her stories, try to match the Shanghai Jing writing with her knowledge about North America.
Right.
She is firmly a believer that Shanghai Jing is a book described North America.
Right.
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 And however, not that many other people sort of believed her. Is that correct?
I think Dr. Covey believed her. My research mentor believed her.
I see.
And he had been on part of the areas on the Shanghai Jing journey, but no one, to my knowledge, had followed the complete trip through the Rocky Mountains until I tried to do it. Mm-hmm. But when we were standing on Bald Mountain, I looked over there and said, they said the next mountain is Bamboo Mountain. I said, there's not going to be bamboo in Texas. This is going to prove the whole theory wrong. Mm-hmm. Because for this to be true, you have to have most of it be right.
Right.
And so we went to a museum the next day and said, is there anything in Texas that looks like bamboo? Mm-hmm. And they said, yes. And we said, well, where is it? Mm-hmm. It was in the location where she had charted it.
Oh, my. Yeah.
And it's the only bamboo that's native to North America. Mm-hmm. Well, now it's extinct in that area, but there are even pictures on the internet today of when it was there not too long ago.
I see. So the museum has records of that?
Yes, yes. That it was there. And then it still survives in a few places along the river because, as you know, bamboo needs a lot of water.
Right.
And the river there is the Rio Grande, and so it still survives, but not in that particular location where she charted it.
Yes, yes.
So then it was several years
so
before.
So this part of a discovery you have written into your book?
Yes, it's in the book.
I see.
But they describe in each location, they give the distance in Chinese li, which we understand to be about a third of a mile.
Right.
But it's sometimes an inexact measure.
Sure. Yeah.
But we used her locations that she had charted on North American maps. Mm-hmm. And when my husband and I went back in, was actually 2012.
Yeah.
So I had actually written this book when I was here last time, and I was biting my tongue because I didn't want to tell it until the book came out. Mm-hmm. So we had actually been there, and I'd found these different things. But you don't talk about the book till the book comes out.
Are you allowed to compare her book and your travel on a very sort of graphical way, and by comparing maps and images?
Yes, I do use her maps and images. It so happens I went to the Library of Congress twice to make sure that the copyright on her book had actually expired. So I was able to put it in there, but I attribute it to her. I don't try to steal her work.
But that helps people sort of understand.
Right.
Because I think your book, as I read through, very interesting as a travel book.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but some people, may be interested in travel. Just reading that book itself is very interesting, and the animals you see, the scenery, and so on. But the historical part, the evidential part, that the Chinese has explored America and went back and wrote the book, and in Shanghai Jing describe it. And how do you really document that one-on-one with all this evidence? That is a different kind of writing.
Right.
So I don't know whether you have written this book in a very interesting traveling way, but I would hope you may want to do that with Henrietta's book and map and her charting, mm-hmm. sort of a step by step, and trying to pinpoint the evidence that you discover or you confirm.
Right. Well, her charts are in this book, mm-hmm. because, as I mentioned, her copyright has expired, so I put those her charts in this book. Mm-hmm. And I do have an abbreviated form of the evidences showing
in there, yeah.
Right. Not just in here, but without the rest of the story in there, mm-hmm. About
I see.
The hot springs.
Well, that's why I say perhaps, you could approach the writing in two different ways. One is from a travel point of view, and it's very interesting and entertaining for people that is interested in the Rocky Mountains. But the other part is a sort of a semi-detective type of a cold case study.
So
cold case study. And then make people realize, the cold case, even though 2007 BC, mm-hmm. or however, I don't know how, however the Shanghai Jin is identified, as suddenly it's closed, mm-hmm. That long. It's, that's just the part that is really amazing.
Right. I tried, because my other books are more, a little bit more academic with so many footnotes, I tried to make
This one is
like a travelogue.
Yeah, right,
travelogue. And I even included some of the stories from American Wild West
that
had happened in the same locations. Mm-hmm. And so I weave this all together, mm-hmm. a little bit of subtle humor. Mm-hmm. I think it's humor. Other people might think.
No, it's a very interesting reading. I recommend people read this. I mean, it's particularly Rocky Mountain, some people may not physically or not able to really go up that high or travel that long, it would be a very interesting reading. Yeah.
Right. And even though that some of the mountains mentioned are 14,000 feet high, you don't have to go to the top of the mountain, mm-hmm. to get a lot of the information. Mm-hmm. And it is a beautiful part of the country, especially if you travel it in the fall, about this time of year.
Right.
It's a beautiful part of the country to see and mm-hmm. very different from Virginia, where we live.
Mm-hmm. Is it possible for you to sort of quantitatively now identify few spots along this journey that's relevant to this Shanghai Jing, writing?
Right. Well, maybe.
How many spots that you think you can correlate?
Well, okay, I can. Probably everyone that's mentioned, I could. I don't know if, mm-hmm. We will do that today, but the very first spot, they start in Casper, Wyoming.
Mm-hmm.
And I went doubtful, mm-hmm. even though we had been to the Texas part of it before. I said, why would Chinese start a survey of North America in Wyoming? It's toward the middle of the country.
Mm-hmm.
This seems very strange, but mm-hmm. it wasn't until I got there that I realized what had happened. Okay, Henrietta Mertz charted mm-hmm. four journeys.
Mm-hmm.
This one was listed first,
mm-hmm.
but two of the journeys had happened on the West Coast.
Mm-hmm.
One had started up in Alaska, had gone down through British Columbia, mm-hmm. through California, went down the mm-hmm. West Coast. Another one was just a little bit inland,
mm-hmm.
and the second one that was a little bit inland ended up right where the California Trail went through the Rocky Mountains.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, when we get to Casper, Wyoming, there was a National Park Service has a historic museum.
Mm-hmm.
So we found out that this was right where the California Trail, the Oregon Trail,
so
the Mormon Trail, they all went through the mountains there. They all had to converge right there because it was the only good pass through the mountains.
Mm-hmm.
And so then I thought, okay, maybe the Chinese came from the west going east, mm-hmm. through that same pass.
Mm-hmm.
And even so, it's a very narrow pass.
Mm-hmm.
And so I said, okay, maybe this makes sense why they would start there.
Mm-hmm.
But then I discovered that just a little bit north of there is Bighorn Medicine Wheel.
And can we show a picture? Maybe. Our studio director there, can you show that bighorn it's let's see, what's the number on this one? I think we
Bighorn Medicine Wheel is
towards the end. Yeah.
I have it in here.
I think if in the sequence of the pictures that you sent me, yeah, it's about number 18 down from roughly.
Bighorn, it's
called Bighorn Medicine Wheel.
Right, and just a little bit north of there.
Yeah. Yeah, you have it. Yeah.
Is Bighorn Medicine Wheel, and that has 28 spokes.
Yeah, spokes on this wheel.
Unevenly spaced around a hub. And when I read about this, I thought, oh my, because my research mentor had first had me study Chinese archaeology. He was a very wise man, and he said, you know, you study Chinese archaeology first. Well, I realized that from the second millennium BC, the Chinese had divided the night sky and into 28 portions, they call mansions, and that was also unevenly spaced around a hub. Now, this is a later design that they had, but, you know, it's the same thing, the 28 spokes. Now, the people at this area, they've gone to, they're trying to study it. People from Stanford are trying to study Bighorn Medicine Wheel. They can't figure out who would have made it. The Native Americans there, they said that, well, it was built before the sun came.
Before the sun,
it was built by the people who didn't have iron. So they don't know who built it, but it was built a long time ago. And yet it's so similar to the Chinese design. Well, then just downriver from this is artwork that people who are academic artists, they've associated this with the artwork from Ningxia, China. Well, the artwork in Ningxia, China is from China's earliest dynasties.
Right, Ningxia.
And so I said, okay, is it a coincidence that the pass through the mountain was right there, that this Bighorn Medicine Wheel is right near there, and this artwork from Ningxia, China is right there, all in the same place. Now, one of the things...
What kind of artwork was...
It's just artwork etching on rocks.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Etching on rocks.
Oh, yes.
That's artwork that they found there. I think it's called Legend Rock or something, but...
It's amazing, you know, so, you know, that long... time that these things actually still preserved.
Well, that area is very unpopulated. In fact, one of the animals that the Shanghai Jing describes as being there is an animal that's about the shape, the size of cattle, and it's striped. And so I had a really hard time with that before I went. I said, what could this possibly be? And then I discovered that antelope... which are prong, actually the name is pronghorn, that they have a stripe across their chest. And they're, today they're more antelope in Wyoming than they are people. And you go through wide expanses of Wyoming with no people. Well, then another thing that is in that area, as I ran across this in a Colorado archaeology book, that they say, we know somebody advanced came through here 2000 BC. They have the date down, the 2000 BC. We know who they went through. We have the mines that they dug. They were actually playing little games. They had little games. It wasn't just work, all work. They were advanced people, but we can't figure out who they were.
This is in Colorado.
It goes from Colorado, goes north through Wyoming. It goes all the way up to up through Canada. This other stretch of people. And this actually matches another one of Henrietta Mertz's maps, the exact map.
So is Henrietta's books, of course, is out of print, right?
No, people have reprinted them. They're available on the internet.
Oh,
Pale Ink is the name of her book. And it also came out later under Gods from the Far East. But she describes this. She just takes a few pages. I've taken the whole book to expand on what she has written and develop each thing that the Shanghai Jing says.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
That's very interesting. So they know that advanced people came through there, but they are refusing to look across the Pacific to see could it possibly be the Chinese. Mm-hmm. But when you see how many things are the same, you say, how can they prove it wasn't the Chinese?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And of course, this Native American really didn't have any correlation with that in the sense of either inherited something or kept something or passed on something?
Well, the Native Americans have Asian DNA. Mm-hmm. So all people, what the DNA studies show now is all people are related.
No, but my question is this, you know, if we say that 2000 BC that the Chinese have been in America, whatever is left there, if there's any people sort of mm-hmm. you know, either inherited or discovered or somehow should have some kind of traceable traceable route, that is to see, oh, the Indians have kept some, the American natives have kept this part of the
as part of their legends.
Yeah,
well, some of the Indian legends do say that they came across the Great Ocean.
Mm-hmm. Well, that part, some people seem to now associate, because Alaska before it was a land bridge, right? There's
well, that's what they say. I'm more inclined to believe that they came by the current that's in the North Pacific, you know. But mm-hmm.
They wanted to believe that the American natives came from other continent.
Right.
However, you know, whether by land or by sea, of course, right. there's no definite proving one way or another. But now your study and all this discussion that we now have certainly suggests that very highly possible the route is by ocean.
Right. Because of the currents in the North Pacific that push objects over. Mm-hmm. And ever since the Japanese tsunami that happened.
Oh, yeah, we know. There's a tsunami. It still pushed stuff over to California.
Right, right.
Yeah.
And in the 20th century, several groups in very small boats, one was even a rowboat, one was mm-hmm. a three-person boat, they tried it out. One was a group of Japanese young people on a raft. Mm-hmm. You know, it's one of those rafts that has a little house on it. And they said that they were in this current. It acts like a riptide, mm-hmm. and it... At the widest point, it's 62 miles wide. This is huge. Mm-hmm. You mm-hmm. really would have to work to get out of that.
Right. So the current basically pushes along. You could just have a boat that's sitting there and let the current take you.
Right. And that's what they say. They mm-hmm. say, we know as soon as you hit this current that you're mm-hmm. in it mm-hmm. and that you can fish the whole way across. It's a warm current, so you're not going to freeze to death. Mm-hmm. And there's plenty of rain. You can catch rainwater the whole way. Mm-hmm. In fact, there's a new book that's coming out in, it's out. The book is out, but a movie's coming out called Unbroken. Mm-hmm. And it's about two American airmen mm-hmm. in World War II that went down.
Oh.
And they were, their plane crashed in the ocean and a life raft came out. Mm-hmm. And they survived for 47 days mm-hmm. on the westward bound current. Mm. Because, see, this is shaped like a racetrack.
Right,
so,
right, right.
So not only could it have brought the Chinese to America, but it could have taken them back. But anyway, these World War II men, they got all the way back, and then they were captured by the Japanese. Mm-hmm. So this story, and it's a very interesting story that mm-hmm. if you haven't read Unbroken.
Right, right. And this current map I've seen also in one of your books somewhere, right?
Right, right.
Yeah. So is that fairly well sort of established now by historian or geologist?
Oh yes, that's put out by that map that I show is put out by the U.S. government. It's National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, mm-hmm. and there's currents like that actually that go around the world. Mm-hmm. It's not, of course, not every single place in the world, but it's like rivers in the ocean. Mm-hmm. And they carry objects back and forth.
Yeah. So at this point, you know, if we recap a little bit, and I've been talking to you, I'm talking to some other people, and sort of all interested in this ancient history part, who has been into America, there seem to be now, you have two definite period of time. this is this 2000, you know, before BC, mm-hmm. is one period of time that is sort of a some evidence sort of suggests that the Chinese have been to, you know, America in that period of time. Then another period is in the Ming Dynasty.
Right, and there were many periods in between.
Right. No, right. But the Ming Dynasty seemed to have more evidence, again, for Chinese have sailed all the way to America. Is that correct assessment?
Well, as I mentioned, different people are studying different parts of it. Now, one of the men, Dr. Carl Johannesson, mm-hmm. he studied plants mm-hmm. that are on the wrong continent. Mm-hmm. For instance, peanuts are native to North America, mm-hmm. and yet he finds them in two different provinces in China, or the Chinese have actually found them. Mm-hmm. He annotates it in his book, mm-hmm. and he is a PhD who is a geographer and also studies plants. Mm-hmm. But peanuts have been found in two different provinces in China and carbon dated to before 2000 BC. Mm-hmm. And also, the cotton in the New World cannot be spun and made into cloth. Mm-hmm. And yet we have evidences of Chinese cotton or an Asian cotton coming to the Americas because we find cloth that's carbon dated to 2000 BC in the New World. Mm. So somebody was traveling back and forth, but he has different dates that different things went back and forth. Mm-hmm. Like the sweet potato went later. Mm-hmm. So what he's finding, and also what John Ruskamp's finding with mm-hmm. the different types of Chinese writing that he's yeah. found, mm-hmm. he's finding different eras of the writing. So all of us are saying it appears that they came many different times.
Right. But isn't, well, I hope somehow, you know, this group of people do this little, like in science, we always do that, is you've got to have a very accurate chronological sort of a lens to see
right.
things.
Right.
And I would hope that you people can really draw that chronological line and says, you know, by certain evidence you establish correlate with the time to make people sort of easily follow and understand
right.
what things are related to what time frame, and then, you know, the whole picture probably could be easily, you know, understood by mm-hmm. people.
Well, there's a writer who teaches at American universities, mm-hmm. or he's actually a professor emeritus now, Paul yeah. Shao, and mm-hmm. he's written books showing mm-hmm. that the artwork of every Chinese dynasty from Shang, mm-hmm. which of course was the second dynasty mm-hmm. forward,
yeah.
has been found almost the same thing in the Americas. And he puts it in his books, he puts the picture side by side. This is what was going on in China. This is what is in the Americas. Mm-hmm. So if you have
people... Oh, this is Shao's book?
Paul Shao's book.
Oh,
and you can get it by interlibrary loan. It's all in English. Mm-hmm. He I think it was Iowa State University mm-hmm. Press that put it out. Mm-hmm. He has two different books. Mm-hmm. But they compare Chinese art and the what was found in the Americas in supervised digs, mm-hmm. you know, where they it wasn't just somebody just finding it on the street and saying, oh, this is, you know, reproduction. Mm-hmm. They know,
yeah.
you know, where they found it. Mm-hmm. But he puts it side by side. Mm-hmm. So when it's coming that often, they do say, you know, this is related to this dynasty, this is related to that dynasty. Mm-hmm. So it might be hard to say exactly what year,
yeah,
like we do in America.
This is the part that I have difficulty to sort of look at this thing, and how do I, you know, if I want to do research in this on this topic, I would mm-hmm. group the evidence first, you know, identified by the chronological dates,
right,
and then try to string them through, mm-hmm. and perhaps can actually picture how these interaction of people travel, you know, in different times with transportation mm-hmm. means and with their, you know, cultural change or custom change or certain things. That would be, you know, fantastic type of, you know, research.
Right.
Perhaps, of course, one person may not be able to do it at all, but it's with groups that mm-hmm. are sharing the interest, I think you know, that ought to be the way to do it. And maybe you have a conference every year or so to, you know, piece this together from the first dynasty of, you know, Chinese first dynasty all the way to now, and how the interaction really mm-hmm. played out.
Right, right. I agree with you. And is it okay if I talk
sure.
about John Ruskamp's book?
Oh, yes,
yeah,
yes.
I'm just talk about it briefly because
right.
I understand
yeah,
you're going to
yeah,
have
I
him come visit.
Right, I invited him and see when he's available. I'll
yes.
be talking to him, yeah.
And he has found Chinese writing etched on rocks
mm.
in many different locations, most of them in protected areas so that someone just can't go up and etch it.
Mm-hmm.
But they know, they can tell by the patina on the rock
mm-hmm.
That it's not something that's recent.
Mm-hmm.
And the most ancient forms of Chinese writing mm-hmm. were found just in the late 1800s.
Mm-hmm.
So they know that because of the patina, very old patina, they know it's not somebody, Chinese people just
how
going there.
How do you identify that age from the patina?
The patina, well, you know how if a picture looks very old,
mm-hmm.
say the picture was taken in the 1940s, we can tell that patina.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, it's a patina like that is yellowing on the rock. If you
right.
scratch it today, it's going to be really white.
Mm-hmm.
And this is out in the middle of
wilderness. Terms of a number of years, though,
no,
that's
it's
difficult.
Very, very difficult, yeah. And you cannot carbon date rock.
Mm-hmm.
So what they've done, how they've dated it, is by the style of Chinese writing.
And
certain dynasties had certain types of writing.
Mm-hmm.
It might be the same word and it might look a little bit the same, but the new ruler in China would say, okay, now we're going to write this word this way.
Mm-hmm.
And so after a period of time, they would write the word this way.
Yeah.
So he's found of several different dynasties in North America.
And Ruskamp, I really hope that he could come, you know, this time with you and we can have sort of several
right.
sessions. But anyway, he probably...
But he's actually found the names of two Shang Dynasty kings
mm-hmm.
and other Chinese words with it. On this particular one, it's...
Where
the
is
offer.
That?
This is near... What this is really interesting, too.
Mm-hmm.
I was on a north-south path.
Mm-hmm.
He was on an east-west path. This was right where the two paths intersected.
Oh.
So when we found out about each other's research, we were both really excited because on this, at the intersection of where, this is near Albuquerque, New Mexico.
Uh-huh, Albuquerque. Yeah.
And it's in an area that's protected by the National Park Service. But it's the name of two different Shang Dynasty kings.
Mm-hmm.
And it says to offer sacrifice, and so, and then it has the names of the two Shang kings. So we think it's something involving ancestor worship because it was post-Shang.
Mm-hmm.
And because of the style of writing, Dr. David Catley, who's from UC Berkeley, has stated that he believes this is sometime between 1200 and 200 B.C.
Mm-hmm.
when this was done.
Mm-hmm.
But another interesting thing is near there, he found another one that gives a forecast for the 10-day week. Well, at that period of time, China had a 10-day week.
I see.
And do you remember the legend of the 10 suns, how that there were 10
suns? Right, yeah, shoot it down or something.
Right, right. That I think that it's tied in with the 10-day week. And that every day a different sun would come up.
Mm-hmm.
And then finally they said that one time all 10 suns came up at one time and the archer had to shoot them down. Of course, that part is imaginary.
Mm-hmm.
But the part with it being 10 suns.
Mm-hmm.
But do you remember where the 10 suns resided?
That I don't know. I haven't.
They resided in the Fusang tree.
Oh.
And Fusang is what we believe on my father's map to be America.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and so when my father was first showing his maps, people didn't believe, oh, you know, Chinese couldn't have gotten to America that early.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what propelled me into all these studies.
Yeah,
you know.
So this study actually, you know, this coming so early is pushed even further, you know, earlier, right?
Right,
earlier.
Right, right.
So some sense, it may have diverted to the earlier sort of focus on the 1400s, you know, that period of time, because the British author, what's his name?
Gavin Menzies.
Yeah. And they all focused on this 1420 or 14... His
1421.
Yeah. So now, with now your journey and Henrietta and all this seem to extend that much, much earlier.
Right. And right? Gavin Menzies has come out with a new book. You know, the 1421 had the Chinese coming to the East Coast. Mm-hmm. Gavin Menzies has a new book, has Chinese coming to the West Coast, and has them coming much earlier.
Right. But even that early is still not as early as what the Shanghai Jing would imply.
Yes, he right. does. He does put it as early as Shanghai Jing.
Oh, he does now?
In fact, he actually goes back. He says maybe it was 40,000 years ago, maybe it was 100,000 years ago, and I said, okay, I'm just going to stick to Chinese history.
Well, you wouldn't have any
Chinese
cultural,
people to come.
Yeah, even evidence from China.
Right.
Even Chinese don't have, they always, very proud of their 5,000 years culture
right,
and history.
Right.
But if you saw 40,000, 100,000, then nobody has anything to offer.
No. Yeah. But Gavin Menzies does not go back that far. But I say, okay, I'm just going to stick with what the Chinese say.
What makes him saying that?
Ask Gavin.
I see.
Yeah, ask Gavin.
Okay. So right now, at this point, what is your sort of a plan for the future?
Well, in November, next month, mm-hmm. I am invited to go to a Shanghai Jing conference in Australia.
Oh.
And it's the first Shanghai Jing conference I've ever heard of.
No, I thought China had a Shanghai Jing conference.
Okay, well, maybe they did, but I've never heard of one before. So this was the first one I've heard of.
Who sponsored this?
La Trobe University. And they're bringing in scholars from all over the world mm-hmm. who have studied different parts of the Shanghai Jing. Now, mm-hmm. some of them have only studied it as philosophy.
Mm-hmm.
Or
yes. As I say, Shanghai Jing... even in China, many people believe that it was a journey to the West. It's sort of like a
made-up story. Yeah, yeah, right. So I'm sure that they're not everyone's going to readily accept what I have to say, mm-hmm. but I wanted to tell them about what I saw and how much matched up.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And so they're paying my way to go to Australia to speak.
They pay your way? Wow, that's
yes,
serious. That's good.
They're that serious.
Long journey. Yeah.
They're paying my way, so I'm going to stop at the University of Hawaii on the way and mm-hmm. speak there. And then mm-hmm.
This is at Melbourne?
In Melbourne. No, yes, La Trobe's in Melbourne. Yes.
Okay.
And then I'll also
very
be
nice.
Speaking
Melbourne's
in Adelaide.
Very nice.
Yes.
Yeah, the Gold Coast is beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
Well, That's very interesting. So that's your immediate activity. And what I was really asking is your future plan in terms of continuing research and longer term. Yeah.
What would you suggest? I'm going to ask you.
Well, I already suggest some. Just take a close chronological view.
Mm-hmm.
And then draw a line, say, well, here I can contribute. Here someone else already have.
Mm-hmm.
There are some, we need to do. Going through that kind of analysis, you are, just imagine you are a professor in the university.
Right.
And you're teaching a course about who discovered America, right?
Mm-hmm.
As the title of your course.
Mm-hmm.
And you want to lead your students to study this course and research material and then have a sort of a complete understanding of this topic.
Right.
How would you do that? Is you would be draw a line on a blackboard, say, here, this is 2007 BC,
mm-hmm.
When first dynasty in China started, and they have their recordings. In fact, Chinese, fortunately, they had recordings very early on,
mm-hmm.
in, as far as traceable type of recordings. And then on this line, you will try to give some tags to indicate possible areas for research for the students. And
right.
They should form a little team and pick their choice going from 2007 BC all the way to certainly modern is very simple. I mean, mm-hmm. now we have lots of interaction from Chinese immigrants. I mean, even that is still interesting research because,
right.
you know, the Chinese came here to build the railroads in California and all that. It's not really well understood.
Right.
You know? A couple of movies in the John Wayne sort of thing. Mm-hmm. You know, here's the railroad workers from China, but there's lots of sort of stories or cultural things that can be, you know, studied. So if you do that, you make these marks and allow people to mm-hmm. form little, you know,
now, others have told me that what I need to do is finish the other three journeys mm-hmm. that Henrietta Mertz charted
mm-hmm.
and see what's there along those routes. Now, I've done some of the preliminary studies on that, but mm-hmm. that would fit into that time chart.
Sure. Yeah. Right. I think the journey part is a distance, whereas timeline is, you know, different.
Right.
If your traveling part happened to intersect with the timeline in a precise way, then you are basically studying a timeline, a marker. You say, here, this is the juncture, you know, we are focusing on.
Uh-huh.
But if the journey discover things, in a sense, does not intersect with timeline at one point, mm-hmm. and it's parallel,
right,
then I would say it's interesting to discover things, but it's very difficult to be conclusive,
mm-hmm.
right? And
at this point, what we're trying to establish is that Chinese were in America early,
mm-hmm.
and I'm not married to a specific date.
Right, right. No, so but that's for, in my view, okay,
uh-huh.
to believe or not to believe the Chinese in America or not.
Mm-hmm.
Does not necessarily have to be a complete proof from 2000 BC
right.
to now, so on. There is enough evidence, however tangential, however direct, you could piece together a hypothesis. This is how people, you know, scientists do research.
Right, right.
And when you study whatever, you know, black hole or this and that, not necessarily have a precise thing, but you've got certain evidence together, you can put a hypothesis mm-hmm. and say that's acceptable. I would say, in my, you know, interaction with some of you and already, I think it's possible for people to put a hypothesis together. Say, the Chinese has been to America before Columbus. That's almost no problem.
But some people say you accept it, but a lot of people don't because this recently.
No, that's because. The you have not put into a clear debate in a forum
mm-hmm.
that's undisputable. Okay, I mean, if you have, then people will not have much argument. Mm-hmm. In other words, when you say you are doing certain research, you are publishing books, you are doing some academic or quasi-academic work, but what it has to crystallize is to have a pure academic forum
mm-hmm.
to make that kind of, you know, hypothesis presented with evidence. Now,
right.
let people debate.
Uh-huh.
Now, that kind of conference, that kind of debate, people have to go away. Either says you don't have a hypothesis,
mm-hmm.
okay? You're totally wrong. Or you say you have a plausible hypothesis. Then what are the things remaining to be done to prove or add evidence to this hypothesis?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and I think that's what you need to do. We need to add to the hypothesis. First, the mm-hmm. hypothesis has to be presented in a forum
mm-hmm.
that people would, you know, accept is a real scientific, you know, sort of academic forum.
Right. Well, there are several people with PhDs who are studying different parts of this.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that they have done, like John Ruskamp has been very careful in what he claims. And
right.
he said he has things that mm-hmm. he doesn't put in here because he doesn't know that he has enough evidence on.
Mm-hmm.
But he is one that has been very careful. But I understand what you're saying about the timeline.
Yeah. And I think you could probably, some of you could approach the American History Society or any history society.
But several of us have tried to.
Yeah.
And the thing is that they're very closed-minded to this type of information coming out.
Mm-hmm.
And, in fact, we got publicity on this in China
mm-hmm.
when I spoke last December, and I said, okay, you also need to write about John Ruskamp's research. It went all over Asia,
mm-hmm.
but none of it came into American news.
Right. Well, that's why I say you need to break into that American, however close-knit academic world. The academic society do, you know, hold conferences. And conferences doesn't have to be blessed by the society. Any society member, even outside member,
mm-hmm.
could sponsor a conference or organize a conference.
But we were just at a conference in mm-hmm. Victoria, and some of the people were laughing at the idea that Chinese ever came to America before Columbus.
Mm-hmm.
So, see, they don't even have the 101, you know.
No.
Chinese discover America 101.
No, when you have a formal conference,
right.
those kind of people, if they want to come, they certainly welcome,
mm-hmm.
and it's given the opportunity for debate. And people have to bring evidence, you know.
Right.
By laughing it off doesn't add anything to it.
No, it doesn't.
So I think to have a formal conference, in my mind, okay, maybe actually a few of you, I'd be happy to join you. This is a formal little society to organize conference on this chronological line
mm-hmm.
to decide, well, this is the time evidence is richer than this time, so you focus on this as first conference, and as mm-hmm. you keep on doing this, maybe then go into other, you know,
mm-hmm.
Sort of a timeline to organize other conferences.
Right.
And when you organize these conferences, you involve different scholars. Ruskamp, you know,
mm-hmm.
is geologist and also has to be knowledgeable about the Chinese calligraphy. Or,
yes, he is.
Right.
Yes.
So you need to sort of organize meetings in a way of trying to extend the evidence, okay, to more sort of a complete explanation of this.
It's not that we haven't tried.
Mm-hmm.
It's that some academic places are very closed-minded to this.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they've written a book saying Columbus has discovered America, so they don't want anybody to...
No, not in science. Ever since Newton or however, you know, how many theories have been disproved or, you know, changed. And it's not always mm-hmm. that you write something down that cannot mm-hmm. be changed. The change has to be backed by evidence and by efforts by
right.
you know, scholars.
You
know, I have to tell you, we have so much interest talking. Time is running out. We have probably only 1 or 2 minutes left. We'll continue another session, try to continue
okay.
this, but this hour is gone by, and I think the director is warning me. Well, you know, I always find it fascinating, you know, have you here and talk about this, and I know some of you, sort of got into this by accident and so
yes.
on. But we need to now really take a serious scientific way of dealing
exactly,
with it.
Exactly.
Yeah. So thank you so much.
Well, thank you, Ifay.
Yeah. We'll keep in touch and we'll invite you back again, hopefully with Ruskamp or others.
Yes.
You know? Because I think enough evidence is there. Last year I told you when I was interested. But I think more I hear, I would now start forming my belief.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, definitely the Chinese been to United America is probably not disputable. The question is how exactly? That's
mm-hmm.
a tougher question. Okay, so you need to do this.
Well, I have someone else that can tell you that too.
Very good. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Is it finished or not? I don't know what it's...